And tonight we're having Peter Erlander, who used to be the head of the National Lawyers Guild, and recently has been doing a lot of really important work in Rwanda, where he was in fact arrested last year for speaking up about what's happening there, and he's going to tell you about that. So I thank you for coming in. I also want to point out that we're going to have a number of other events that surrounding questions of Africa, the Alame Breath Global Africa Lecture Series will start next Tuesday with a discussion of Sudan, which will include a discussion of Darfur, which is very related to what's going to be talked about tonight, as well as a discussion of South Sudan and the referendum, what all that means, and that will be next Tuesday, February 1st, here at 7:30. And also, we'll have the second of that series will be March 2nd, will be on Democratic Republic of Congo. So there's some flyers around the Rec Forum you can get and learn more about. Go to the Rec Forum website, recforum.org. Anyway, without further ado, I'd like to welcome Peter Erlander to speak.
So, thanks. Well, I appreciate the introduction, but I want to make clear that I'm not really an expert on Rwanda. I'm an expert on the United States and the abuse of United States power, both domestically and internationally. I came to my understanding of the U.S. Abuse of power with respect to Rwanda by becoming a defense counsel at the United Nations International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda. In addition to working on as a defense lawyer at the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda, presently I'm also working on protecting and enlarging the hunting and fishing rights of the Anishinaabe people in northern Minnesota. I'm happy to say that we are on the cusp of reestablishing rights that were guaranteed by the United States government in 1825 that have been taken away. In addition to that, tomorrow we are having a meeting of the National Coalition to Protect Civil Freedoms, which is a national organization that is building a movement against the targeting of Muslims and the manufactured charges against Muslims that have been in the papers all too recently, and the made-up terrorism investigations and prosecutions that you've also read about. So to the extent that Rwanda is the thing I'm going to be talking about tonight, it's not the sole focus of my work. Also, I want to make clear that I don't have opinions about what happened in Rwanda beyond those things that I learned by getting access to the United Nations documents and the United States government documents that were generated by people in the United Nations who were in Rwanda in 1993 to 1994, and documents were generated by the United Nations and others since that time. And to the extent that people disagree with what those documents say or what I think those documents say, they're free to examine them and reach their own conclusions. So that's the reason that my work is titled The Preventing the Falsification of History, The Unintended Consequences of International Tribunal Disclosure Rules, because what happened was in 2003, I went to Arusha, Tanzania to decide whether I should take a case or not. While I was there, Carlo Del Ponte, who was the chief prosecutor of the tribunal, had a press conference in which she announced that she was prepared to prosecute Paul Kagame for the assassination of the previous president, Juvenal Habyarimana, and was prepared to prosecute the winners of the war, the RPF, for war crimes and crimes against humanity. That, I thought, was a significant event because, of course, only the losers of the war had been prosecuted up until that moment. The tribunal had existed for 10 years. As a student of history, it seemed to me that there had never been a war in which only one side had committed crimes. And I thought it was a great advance that the prosecutor was willing now to prosecute both sides. The next day, there was a press conference in Kigali where Mr. Kagame demanded her resignation, which of course I would have done had I been Mr. Kagame also. 2 days later, however, there was a press conference in Washington, D.C., where Secretary of State Colin Powell was answering questions of the international press about the weapons of mass destruction. And he was assuring members of the international press that the weapons would turn up any moment now, and to just be patient, because certainly the weapons would show up soon, because the story of the victors in the Iraq War was that there were certainly weapons of mass destruction that justified what the United States were doing. And we should just wait, because that was the story of the victors. In that press conference, someone said, I don't know who it was, well, we just had this report of Kagame calling for Carlo Del Ponte to be removed from office because she called for the prosecution of the RPF. And Colin Powell said something like, well, yes, we agree with that, and then went on. Well, of course, the world didn't pay attention to that because they didn't know anything about Rwanda. They didn't know anything about the ICTR. But I was focused on that, of course, and I was sitting in the bar at the Impala Hotel drinking a Tusker, and I fell off my chair. Why would the Secretary of State of the United States, when he was assuring the people of the world that the weapons of mass destruction would be found, which we now know was a lie, would take time from this public relations campaign to announce that the United States also supported removing Carlo Del Ponte from office because she was announcing she was going to do her job? That's what convinced me I should sign up as a defense lawyer, because I needed to figure this out. I didn't find out why that was the case. She was removed from office 2 months later, until February of 2009, when she published her memoirs. And in February of 2009, her memoirs reported that around the same time, she was called to the State Department by Pierre Prosper, who was the war crimes ambassador under Mr. Bush. She was informed that she would not prosecute the RPF for Mr. Kagame, even though she had the evidence to do so, because the United States had determined that those prosecutions would not happen, and that if she insisted on following the evidence that she had to prosecute the side that won the Rwandan war, she would be removed from her office. When she responded by saying, I followed the evidence and I work for the United Nations, not for the United States, Mr. Prosper said, you've just lost your job, and she was removed from office in 2 months, according to her memoirs, not according to me. And of course, at the ICTR, only the losing side has been prosecuted to this day, which means that either the Rwanda war is the only war in history in which only one side has committed crimes, or it's a tribunal that's been manipulated for political reasons, which is what Ms. Del Ponte has reported based on her own experience. When she published her memoirs, it was also reported in press that the Swiss government, for whom she is an ambassador, ordered her not to discuss her book in public. She hasn't done so. Her chief deputy, Florence Hartman, wrote a similar book in French covering the same topics. She was prosecuted by the ICTY criminally. She was convicted and fined about $7,000. And her case is now on appeal. But I think that it's important to reflect on the effect that those prosecutions and that firing would have on anyone who was associated with the ICTR, who was a judge or a prosecutor or an employee who had the idea that they might want to follow the evidence that indicated what the real story was with respect to what happened in Rwanda, if it wasn't the story that was approved by the State Department or by the Pentagon. Now, this, of course, does not say anything about Rwanda, because it's not the first time it happened. You may recall that there was a Academy Award-winning documentary about 5 years ago called The Fog of War. It was a interview with Robert McNamara, who explained his own involvement with Vietnam, which we know was an enormous mistake by the United States, not by the Rwandan government, but by the United States government, in which they killed many, many people in Vietnam. Some would say that that was a genocide committed by the United States. It was not a war that the United States people are proud of today. But in the course of telling the story about Vietnam and apologizing for his role in Vietnam, Mr. McNamara began the story, or at least the documentary began, with these pictures, which are newsreel photographs from Tokyo. It's not well remembered, but before Hiroshima and Nagasaki, Tokyo was bombed with napalm. 250,000 Japanese civilians were killed by American gasoline bombs. It was something like a genocide committed by the United States. And Mr. McNamara said these words, that if the Japanese had won the war, he and the other planners of the firebombing of Tokyo would have been the war criminals. Because, of course, the winners of the war have the opportunity of deciding who the criminals will be. This doesn't include the nuclear bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. This is killing people the old-fashioned way, just by dropping gasoline. So the idea that a tribunal might be used by the victors to tell the story that favors their viewpoint is not something that would happen just in an African country, just in the context of Rwanda. And of course, that doesn't mean that the Rwandan government is any better or any worse than the United States government. In fact, we have the example, and following the U.S. history. But it's also interesting to remember that in the Tokyo tribunals, the decision was made not to prosecute the emperor, because politically, the winner of the war decided that it would be easier to control the Japanese people if the emperor remained in power. So the political decision was made with respect to how the tribunal would be used in order to effectuate the political interests of the dominant party who had won the war. It's also true that in the Nuremberg tribunals, as terrible as the death camps were and the crimes of the Nazis, it's also true that the first bombing of civilians on a mass scale was carried out by the British in the bombing of German cities, carpet bombing of a huge scale, of an industrial scale that had never happened in the world before. It's also true that the killing of civilians on the Eastern Front was on a mass scale that far eclipsed the deaths that occurred in the death camps. And that doesn't in any way diminish the horror and the guilt of the Nazis, but it does make clear that victor's justice was the nature of those tribunals. So the question then is, how are we to think about a tribunal that Carlo Del Ponte, the chief prosecutor, has told us has prosecuted only the losers, and that the evidence exists to prosecute the winners, although the United States has not allowed that to occur? What is the story that the winners have told? The story is that in the space of 100 days, for reasons that the winners have described, close to 1 million Rwandans were killed, that they were Tutsis. The question is, who are the Tutsis? How were they killed? And if this is the order of the killing, how is it possible? There must have been some industrial program, or there must have been some structure. There must have been some long-term planning. There must have been some organization. How is it possible for that many people to be killed in 100 days? Well, this is the story that those who won the war have told, with the assistance of those who have been their supporters. And we'll see how it is the supporters and the winners of the war have told that story. But before we get into the story of Rwanda, because that's really a subset of the larger story of the manipulation of international tribunals in ways that benefit the powerful. And we shouldn't think that these international tribunals are unique in that way, because it's even true in the domestic legal fora that we're familiar with. And I just want to review the small steps that we've taken to inject fairness and law into moderating the use of power. It was only in 1250 in the Anglo-American system that the barons confronted King John and forced the sovereign to give up some of the sovereign's power. Up until that time, British sovereign could exercise power without limit. There was some limitation on power where the aristocracy limited King John's power. 400 years later, after Parliament and Cromwell had carried out a revolution displacing the sovereign, there was a reestablishment of the monarchy with a power-sharing agreement between the aristocracy, the rising business classes, and the sovereign, and an unwritten constitution in which the rising business classes in England had more power. Still, the sovereign was the sovereign, and if you noticed in England, it wasn't necessary for Tony Blair to go to Congress or the Parliament to declare war. He could do it himself as the representative of the sovereign. There's still the remnants of the feudal system operating in Britain. There's a written constitution in the United States. That is a development in terms of limitations on sovereignty. The only way that the Constitution could be ratified is from opposition to the Founding Fathers that added a Bill of Rights that the Founding Fathers didn't want. There were limitations on international relations in these Geneva Conventions. World War I and the League of Nations, an agreement between nations that supposedly had some effect on limiting the sovereignty of nations in 1919. Let's go to the next slide. A war of aggression, Germany against the other nations of Europe, 20 million killed on the Eastern Front, Soviet retribution in Germany, huge killing there, Hiroshima, Nagasaki, the bombing of Tokyo, the United Nations Charter imposed by the victors, and even today, the five permanent members of the Security Council decide how it is these tribunals are going to be set up. A world court is set up in the UN Charter, but again by the winners of World War II. And we know about the Nuremberg trials, victors' justice, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the Genocide Convention. But this is all brand new, and really the beginnings of attempting to establish some sort of legal limitation on the exercise of raw power. The next one, please. I'm not going to review these in great detail, but I want you to I want to try and establish the idea that all of this stuff is extremely new, and we get down to 2003 when the U.S. invades Iraq in self-defense to protect us from weapons of mass destruction that, of course, didn't exist. This is so inconvenient because we. But now I want to talk at least briefly about Rwanda, so we can get into the tribunal aspects relating to Rwanda. Small country in Central Africa, the Hutu-Tutsi divide initially really is based on the difference in the way that people make their living. Hutus are largely farmers, 80% of the population. Tutsis are herders. This division exists in many parts of East Africa between agriculturalists and pastoralists. The Tutsis are great warriors. They had become largely the aristocracy in this part of Africa. The Europeans had not penetrated there. The Arabs had not penetrated there. No slave penetration in that area. Rwanda was an independent kingdom and an independent state, highly organized before the Europeans showed up. First, the Germans were present. After World War II, the Belgians were given control of Burundi and Rwanda, and considered really one colony, and more or less attached to the Belgian Congo for administrative reasons. And the Belgians then began differentiating in a more formal way between the Tutsis and the Hutus, and using the Tutsi as the local rulers to further the colonial project. That's an attempt to shortcut a history that, of course, is much more complex than I can do justice with it now. But I think that those of us who have studied colonialism understand the use of the local aristocracy as an agent of colonial control, which certainly does is the case with respect to Rwanda and Burundi both. Please. In order to talk about Rwanda and Burundi, it really is necessary to talk about both, because the ethnicity in both countries is virtually the same. The languages are very similar. Both written and spoken languages, the religions are the same. There's relatives across the borders in both countries. The reflections of one country are felt in the other. And they were considered essentially one colony by the Belgians, and so the relationship between the two is very close. However, after independence, the political situation both were quite different. After independence from the Belgians, Burundi continued to be ruled by a Tutsi military dictatorship, and the aristocracy in Burundi was never displaced. They continued to be in place until 1993, when there was the first election in Burundi, and so from 1962 thereabouts through 1993, the military dictatorship was in control. In Kigali and in Rwanda, a Hutu republic was established, and a revolution occurred in which the Tutsi aristocracy and monarchy was displaced, and large numbers of Tutsi were driven out of the country. In order to put it in terms that we might understand in the US, it was a little like what happened in Cuba after the Cuban Revolution. And the result was that not all Cubans that remained were African Cubans, and not all Cubans that left were Spanish Cubans, but most of the Rwandans that left were Tutsi Rwandans, and most of the Rwandans that stayed were Hutu Rwandans and agriculturalists, aristocratic Rwandans, although not one for one. And there were Tutsis that remained, some Hutus left, and they went into Uganda and formed a distinct group in Uganda and began to try and make their lives in Uganda, began speaking English the way that Cuban expatriates began making their lives in South Florida and attempted to situate themselves in Uganda. In the meanwhile, in Burundi, the military dictatorship carried out huge massacres of the Hutu majority in 1972 and 1988, on the order of 250,000 people or more. And of course, those people all had relatives in Rwanda. And so there was this underlying mistrust that developed because of that. There had been a number of attempted small invasions of Tutsi expatriates into Rwanda and retaliation killings of Tutsis as a result of that, who were innocent people who were killed because there had been these incursions into Rwanda, and there was discrimination against the Tutsis, no question about that. Although there were a lot of Tutsis that remained in business, it was hard for them to get jobs in government, and the Hutus were favored in government jobs from that point forward because they were now in positions of power in the government. But what happened in the four-year war, in the Rwandan genocide that you hear about 100 days, but actually there was 4 years of war that preceded that 100 days. In October of 1990, about a significant portion of the Ugandan army broke off of the Ugandan army and invaded Rwanda. Now, this portion of the Ugandan army was largely made up of Rwandans. And the Ugandan army had carried out a five-year war from 1981 to 86 under the leadership of Museveni, who's now the president of Uganda. Paul Kagame was his head of military intelligence. During that war, about 500,000 Ugandans were killed, but Museveni won. Initially, the idea was that these Ugandans or these Rwandans were going to become part of the Ugandan hierarchy and society, but Museveni wasn't able to accomplish that because of domestic opposition. So the promise he made of these people becoming Ugandans was cut off. Kagame was studying at Fort Leavenworth in October of 1990. He came back. The troops from the Ugandan military were defeated. It was about 2,500 troops. They withdrew into the Virunga Mountains in January of 91, thereabouts. These are the mountains in southwestern Uganda where Guerrillas in the Mist happened, and that's where Diane Fossey was. Between January of 1991 and February 1993, the RPF changed from an army of 2,500 defeated troops to an army of more than 20,000 well-armed, well-equipped, highly organized troops that carried out a military assault on the nation's capital that would have taken the nation's capital except for the presence of French and Belgian military advisors. Now, an extraordinary feat. And Mr. Kagame is a wonderful, an absolutely extraordinary military commander. But the question is, how does a group of defeated Ugandan soldiers in the Virunga Mountains in southwestern Uganda go from 2,500 beaten troops to an army of more than 20,000 highly organized, highly trained, well-supplied troops in 2 years in the Virunga Mountains and become a fighting force more effective than the Ugandan army itself that spawned them? must be magic. With that assault, about 1/6 of the population was displaced. The result of that, according to General Dallaire of the UN when he wrote a report in September of 1993, was that the country was awash in weapons, that it was completely destabilized, that there were grenades for sale for $3 apiece in the markets. There were bandits all over the country and roadblocks being set up all over the country. And when you hear the story about what happened in Rwanda during the Rwandan genocide, you hear all of those stories being told as though the first time they happened were in April of 1994. But if you read the reports generated by the UN, you see that those things were actually happening 6 months or 9 months before April of 1994 as a consequence of this military assault in February of 1993. In order to give you an idea of how this occurred, this is where the Virunga Mountains are. And the assault went from the Virunga Mountains down through Byumba towards Kigali. The troops of the RPF got almost here and then withdrew back up into this area here and continued to occupy a salient up in this area inside Rwanda, and they continued to occupy the this zone in the northeastern part of the country. The troops of the government forces, there were two classes of troops. There were troops that were well organized and well trained, about 6,000 to 7,000 of those, according to General Dallaire, that were here and here. They had about 30,000 troops that came into the war after the invasion of the RPF that, according to General Dallaire, were not effective fighting troops and what he called rabble. And he said they weren't capable of defending the country or carrying out any military activity. And they were placed around the RPF forces as a tripwire so that if the RPF advanced, then the well-trained troops would be able to come up to back them up, but they weren't considered a significant fighting force. Okay, let's go on to the next one. All right. So in July of 93, the State Department is pushing a power-sharing agreement between all the parties in Rwanda with the RPF. And it makes a lot of sense. It'd be great if that's possible. But in order for that to be possible, the militarily dominant power, which has now been firmly established because of the RPF advance, it's now clear that they can take the country, it's not a matter of debate. It would mean that in order for the power sharing agreement to work, the RPF would have to give up its military dominance. But at the same time, the State Department is asking them to do that. They're continuing to get materiel and military support through Uganda. Uganda is a major client of the United States and the UK, and the military supplies keep coming in. Well, about the same time is that this agreement is signed in July, Burundi, and let's go back for just a moment, Burundi has its first presidential election. So here the negotiations are going on to for power sharing. Here they have the first presidential election, and surprisingly enough, a Hutu gets elected. But here we have great promise, because if we can reach a power sharing agreement here, and the Hutu majority can play a role in politics in Burundi, maybe we can have peace. But by October of 1993, what happens is the first elected president of Burundi gets assassinated by the Burundian military. The Burundian military is a military ally of the RPF. At the same time, in Rwanda, the UN replaces the French and Belgian troops that had provided the backstop that prevented the RPF from taking Kigali in February of 93, are now replaced with peacekeeping forces that are non-combatants, which means the only force that had a potential of stopping the RPF advance in February are now gone. Burundi explodes in violence. At least 100,000 people are killed. These are the cousins, nephews, nieces, relatives of the Hutus in Rwanda. 300,000 of these people pour into Rwanda. There's already 1.2 million that have been displaced by the RPF advance in February. From the Hutu perspective, you can't trust the Tutsi military in Burundi. The RPF has already displaced Grandma and Grandpa back home and destroyed the farm back in the northwestern part of Rwanda. What the hell is going on with these people? How can we possibly have a power-sharing agreement? And that is not my opinion, because this was the testimony of U.S. Ambassador Robert Flotten at the Rwanda Tribunal. He came to Arusha and he testified that he met personally with Mr. Kagame. And he told Mr. Kagame, in light of the military advance of February of 1993 and the displaced people that it's caused, in light of the assassination of President Ndadaye in Burundi, and the huge massacres in Burundi and the displacement of people, in light of all of these things happening, not because there is a conspiracy to commit genocide, but because of the huge damage caused by this war and because of the assassination of the president, if you or Habyarimana start the war again in Rwanda, you're going to be responsible for the same kind of mass violence that happened in Burundi. You'll be responsible for that here in Rwanda, Mr. Kagame. I didn't say that to Mr. Kagame, the U.S. ambassador did. Fear, destabilization, guerrilla war was facing the people in Rwanda. Now, what we also know from the UN documents is that between November of 1993 and April of 1994, the attempt to put the power-sharing agreement into effect was not blocked by the Habyarimana government, which is what the government that has won the war has said. The UN documents show something quite different. The UN documents show that by March 28th, all of the parties involved, including the Habyarimana government, had agreed to put the power-sharing government in place. The documents signed by the Papal Nuncio, the United States government, the Habyarimana government, everybody in place, but not the RPF representatives, had already been agreed to. And of course, that made good sense, because had the document been signed onto, it would have been necessary to give up the military superiority that had already been established that General Dallaire reported in his reports. Well, we know from the subsequent indictments that were issued by a French judge and by a Spanish judge and by the testimony of members of the shoot-down crew at the Rwanda Tribunal, as well as RPF officers that were at the Malindi headquarters of the RPF the night that the president's plane was shot down, that within an hour, less than that, of the shooting down of the president's plane, the order for the final assault to seize power was given by General Kagame. The plane was, of course, shot down, and the predicted violence predicted by the U.S. ambassador erupts. Because of a pre-planned conspiracy to commit genocide, perhaps. But that's not what the State Department thought. Because this is what Prudence Bushnell, who is head of the Africa desk, said the night of the shooting down of the plane. She said, if, as it appears, both presidents have been killed, there's a strong likelihood that widespread violence could break out either in either of the countries, particularly if it's confirmed that the plane was shot down. This was Prudence Bushnell's opinion. And of course, this was consistent with what the U.S. ambassador had told Kagame several months before because of the conditions and the scene. But then we have the record about how the war progressed that also gives us some insight into how it was that events occurred and unfolded. What we know is that between the dates of April 6th and April 27th and April 29th, there was an assault of the majority of RPF troops that swept from the northern part of the country down to the southern part of the country, and the entire eastern third of Rwanda was occupied by the RPF in a period of a few weeks. According to General Dallaire, not to me, General Dallaire in the UN reports said this was a blitzkrieg operation. A blitzkrieg means a well-prepared, highly organized operation in which materiel and the support necessary to move troops has been organized ahead of time, which in fact is what this shows. Also, the UN reports show that as early as the first part of May, the UN was getting reports from this area that civilians were being killed in areas that were being occupied by the RPF. Now, I don't know whether those reports are accurate or not, but I do know that the UN has those reports from the UN High Commissioner for Refugees. We also know that the reports from General Dallaire show that on April 21st, he met with Mr. Kagame and said to him that he couldn't understand why Mr. Kagame wasn't using his troops to stop the killings. And according to General Dallaire, Mr. Kagame told him that that wasn't part of his war plan because and that General Dallaire also said that although the side that had was militarily weaker had asked for a ceasefire and had asked to join troops in order to put down the massacres, that General Kagame had told Dallaire that he wasn't going to do that because he was winning the war, and General Dallaire said that he understood that completely. Because, of course, he was winning the war, and there was no point in his using troops for any other purpose. But perhaps that wasn't true. That's just what's in the UN documents. The other thing we know from the UN documents is that repeatedly the side that lost the war asked General Kagame at that time, to please stop the assault, because they didn't have enough troops in order to defend against the invasion, and put down the massacres. General Dallaire agreed that, in fact, that was true. They didn't have enough troops to do that. General Dallaire concluded that Mr. Kagame was doing what a military commander would normally do, and I leave it up to anybody who's interested to read the UN documents and see for themselves what it was that General Dallaire was reporting at the time. Then these are the reported requests that were going on between April and July, and where General Dallaire says that he repeatedly talked to General Kagame about why it was he wasn't using his troops to stop the massacres, and there's plenty of reports of that in the UN documents. People can read that. But the most interesting thing from a U.S. standpoint, which of course is what I'm interested in, is that between July and August, a USAID investigator, Robert Gersony, spent 6 weeks behind the RPF lines. He was sent in there by USAID, tasked to UNHCR. And after those 6 weeks, he came out and made a report. I think it's called the Gersony Report. And it's not so much a written report as oral reports made to Kofi Annan, a number of other government officials, and a cable was sent to Warren Christopher reporting this as well, that the RPF, according to Mr. Gersony, was killing 10,000 people a month in military style with their hands tied behind their backs. This is also in the UN documents. You can read that for yourself. Foreign minister at that time was a Mr. Najibullah, who had been the French ambassador, or the ambassador to France in the previous government. He was confronted at the UN here in New York. We have the minutes of that meeting. He was confronted again in Washington, D.C. We have the minutes of that meeting. These crimes of the RPF were laid at his doorstep. He decided he didn't want to be part of a regime that was committing those sorts of crimes, and he went into asylum. But then a cover-up of the crimes began in October of 1994, because according to the director of USAID, who I personally interviewed, USAID and the State Department were not aware of how involved the Pentagon had been with the building up of the RPF. And of course, the problem that causes for the United States is it means the United States was actually complicit in the military buildup and the strategy that made it possible for the mass killing in Rwanda to take place. And we can go on. Now, the problem that this causes is that because the ICTR has prosecuted only the losing side in the war, as did the Nuremberg and Tokyo tribunals, we're left with this problem that either it's the only war in history where only one side committed crimes, or it's a politically manipulated tribunal, and Carlo Del Ponte has explained that it's the latter. Now, that doesn't mean that there weren't people killed for ethnic reasons and the Tutsis weren't killed for ethnic reasons in Rwanda. But also, Hutus were certainly killed in Rwanda, and people were killed for other reasons in Rwanda. After all, it was a war. But since that time, a French judge and Spanish judge have both indicted the leaders of the RPF for the assassination of Habyarimana and a whole variety of other crimes, although Kagame continues to allege that the killing of the president was done by the Hutus. This is the affidavit from Queens prosecutor, Michael Horrigan, who was the chief investigator for the ICTR. And this is his testimony, that in late January or February 1997, members of the national team, which was the investigative team at the ICTR, were approached by three informants, or either former or serving members of the RPF, who claimed direct involvement in the 1994 attack on the president's airplane, and their evidence specifically implicated the involvement of Paul Kagame. Michael Horrigan informed Judge Arbour, who then was the chief prosecutor, that's Louise Arbour, who went from this position to the Canadian Supreme Court, and now she's president of the International Crisis Group. He informed Judge Arbour in considerable detail about the information implicating Kagame. Judge Arbour advised him that the national team investigation was at an end because, in her view, it was not in the mandate of the tribunal to prosecute the assassination of Habar Yamaneh. She asked him if the memo that he prepared was the only copy. He informed her that it was, and she said she was pleased to hear that, placed it in her filing cabinet, and then he resigned. It turns out that that was the only copy, but he had the original, and we put the original into the record at the ICTR. The description of events is supported by an FBI agent, James Lyons, whose affidavit is also on the web. It's also supported by Amadou Demi, who was the chief military intelligence officer for General Dallaire. His affidavit is also on the web, and it's also in evidence at the ICTR and is up on the Rwanda Documents Project, which is the website that I have up. Which of course is also confirmed by Carla Del Ponte in her memoirs. This is part of the indictment of the Spanish judge. In February of 2008, Judge Morales issued this 182 indictment, page indictment, in which he specifies about 312,000 individual deaths committed by the RPF in Rwanda. Now, I don't know if these deaths actually occurred or not, because I wasn't in Rwanda, but I do know that this French judge, or a Spanish judge, thought it was significant enough that President Kagame should be charged with these and held accountable for these. And I do know that Carla Del Ponte also thought that he should be charged with mass crimes and was ordered not to prosecute him by the United States for political reasons. In Kigali, 20,000, rural Kigali, 37,000, Gitarama, 40,000, Butari, 35,000, Gikongo, 17, Kibuye, 34, Gisenyi, 3,000, Ruhungeri, 9,000, Biyumba, 74,000, and there's a lot of evidence about people being killed in the Biyumba Stadium in the early stages of the war. And Kibungu is actually the site of the investigations that Gersony reported on, where he said that he was sure that at least 10,000 a month were being killed there, and about 40,000 dead, according to the Spanish judge. These are at least some of the crimes that Carla Del Ponte was told that she couldn't prosecute by the U.S. State Department. Now, this is the opening statement that Carla Del Ponte made in the case that I defended, because Colonel Bagasora was supposed to be the leader and the centerpiece of the long-term conspiracy to commit genocide that explains how 800,000 people were killed in Rwanda because of the long-term planning of the guys who were the guys who lost the war. And this was the story that was told by the prosecutor, and this is the story told by the guys who won the war, and told actually by, I've noticed some of my friends here from Rwanda who believe this story, and I'm sorry that you haven't been told the whole story, but as I know it's painful. But this is the story. The indictment alleged that Bagasora and the other commanders, one of whom was my client, were part of a group of senior Hutu officers who had for several years planned the systematic, for several years, planned the systematic extermination of the Tutsis. Not just civilians, but the Tutsis and moderate Hutus. Now, the thing that's strange about this is that if it was extermination of Tutsis and moderate Hutus, killing moderate Hutus is a political decision. That doesn't fit the definition of genocide. Sorry. In order to secure the Hutu extremist political domination. Another strange thing is Victoire Ingabire, who I went to represent in Rwanda, she read that and she said, well, if moderate Hutus were the victims, why is it that there aren't any memorials to Hutus in Rwanda? Because Hutus were victims too. And there aren't any memorials to Hutus in Rwanda. And if you say that Hutus were victims too, you're a genocide denier in Rwanda. However, after 7 years of trial, based on this indictment, this is what the court decided. When viewed against the backdrop of targeted killings and massive slaughter perpetrated by civilian and assailants, notice, civilian and assailants, not government, not military, right? The people who responded to the assassination of the two presidents, as Ambassador Flotten said they would, as Prudence Bushnell said would happen if the presidents were shot down, as they were, between April and July, as well as earlier cycles of violence, because there had been earlier killing, not only in Rwanda, but also in Burundi, it is understandable why, for many, this evidence shows a prior conspiracy to commit genocide. It's understandable why people would think that. Of course. However, they are also consistent with preparations for a political or military power struggle. When confronted with circumstantial evidence, because there is no hard evidence, unfortunately for the folks who wish there was, after 7 years, in which the evidence of the radio stations and the evidence of the militias and all of the stories that the Rwandan government has told can only convict where this is the only reasonable inference. The prosecution and the Rwandan government has not shown that the only reasonable inference based on credible evidence was that the genocidal intention was shared by the accused being the top four military officers in the former government, including Colonel Bagasora, who was supposed to be the ringleader. The chamber is not satisfied that the prosecution has proved beyond a reasonable doubt that the four conspired among themselves or with others to commit genocide before it unfolded on April 7th. Because on April 7th, people were killed for ethnic reasons. Sure. Their president had been killed. They had been invaded by an army that identified itself as a Tutsi army. Who was the enemy? Who was around us? Who were the infiltrators? But a plan? A conspiracy? After 7 years of trial, the court didn't find that. Maybe there was one. What Carla Del Ponte said, based on her experience of being removed from her office, is it's unfair that politics undermines our work. I find it wounding to see that we have managed to ridicule the principles of international justice because Kagame has signed a bilateral agreement with the United States. And of course, it's more than a bilateral agreement because she didn't know about the UN documents that we've found that show that the creation of the RPF was actually something that began in Arlington, Virginia. This is the resolution that was proposed by some friends I have in Congress. Happily, Betty McCollum and Keith Ellison, and I put this here because it makes clear that not everyone in the United States has swallowed wholesale that Mr. Kagame's government should receive uncritical support from the United States. This was the resolution. That the government of Rwanda to immediately release human rights lawyer Peter Erlander, that the government of Rwanda is supposed to build a state based on the rule of law, based on respect for fundamental human rights, democracy, power sharing, tolerance, and that the increasing pattern of restrictions of free expression in Rwanda ahead of the August presidential election, including the denial of a work visa to a senior human rights lawyer, the crackdown on opposition members and journalists, whereas the United States has provided over $1 billion tax-funded foreign assistance since 2000, $240 million in 2011, and talks a bit about me and that I'm currently being held in Kichikira prison on charges of genocide and ideology based upon my arguments made in my work as a defense lawyer at UNICTR. But also more importantly, I have never made a public comment within the boundaries of Rwanda. I was charged with this crime for statements that I've made in the United States and articles I wrote in my office in Minnesota. And Rwanda has said that anybody who makes a statement that they decide is contrary to the Rwandan government interest anywhere in the world is subject to arrest, not only to arrest in Rwanda, but they have the right to issue arrest warrants through Interpol to have them arrested anywhere in the world if they cross an international border, which is what I am facing now. In addition to that, the president of Rwanda has issued a wanted dead or alive order for me in Kigali in October of last year. In addition to that, on October 1st, 2010, the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees has issued a 600-page report in which the UN has found that from 1993 to 1994, or from 1993 to 2003, the Rwandan government has committed crimes of genocide, war crimes, and crimes against humanity in the Eastern Congo on a massive scale. And the Security Council has reports of the government of Rwanda stealing resources from the Eastern Congo on the range of $250 million a year at least in 2001, 2002, 2003, 2008, and then the mapping report of 2010, and they're accusing me of committing a crime? Please. And I'd like those who are supporting the Rwandan government to please stand up and explain to me the nerve that you have. Please. Would you explain to me why it is that Hutus cannot claim that they're victims of the RPF? Because the latest information that Davenport and Stam have developed based on analyzing the actual reports of crimes committed in Rwanda in 1994 show that twice as many Hutus were killed as Tutsis according to those reports. Now, perhaps those reports are wrong, but at least some Hutus were killed, weren't they? And so where are the memorials to the Hutu victims?
Excuse me, I
don't think that's the basis of the argument here.
If you I'm asking you a simple question.
If you ask
I'm asking you a simple question.
I think the question was that you asked.
Can we finish a little
bit? Oh, sure.
I think you asked the question, those who said support the government of Rwanda to stand up. I would stand on those grounds and I support the government of Rwanda.
Sure.
Period. Question number two, I didn't answer, so I will give you your time back to finish
okay.
the presentation,
thank you.
And then we'll go back.
Thank you. Okay. I have to apologize. The difficulty I have is last night we were at another event, and it's very hard, based on what I've said here. I don't think I've denied genocide. Last night, you know, several of you said that I did, based on what I said last night. I don't think I denied genocide tonight. However, I just want to serve notice that if you're going to accuse me of genocide denial, I'm going to ask you to explain to me how you can justify Rwanda's role in the Congo based on the mapping report, based on the report of 2001, 2002, 2003, and why it is that there aren't any memorials to Hutus in Rwanda. I'm sorry, this has become such a bizarre discussion, because of course Tutsis were killed in Rwanda. And maybe there was a secret conspiracy that the court couldn't find evidence of.
Can I respond to that?
Sure.
Well, first of all, bringing the Congo into this is the opposite of my threat. Okay, I was saying that, first of all, bringing the Congo conflict into this is like comparing apples and oranges, right? If we're here to talk about Rwanda, Rwanda's involvement into the Congo, it should be a different topic altogether. So I don't want to get into that. On the issue of whether you deny the genocide or not, that's one of the reasons actually I came to this forum.
Okay.
Because I've read numerous times that one of the reasons you were arrested in Rwanda was because you are a genocide denier.
Mm-hmm.
And you haven't, you know, come out clearly to say whether you deny it or not. I was like, well, this is an opportunity. He's in New York. Go ask him. So my first question to you is, do you deny whether the genocide occurred or not? And I tried throughout your presentation to, you know, get cues. Several times you referred it to as a war, you know, some people might say the war, genocide, but my first question, I have a list of questions for you, but my first question is, you know, you're a lawyer, and I read law books and watch movies, they're big on this thing, answer yes or no. Do you agree that there was a genocide in Rwanda, or do you deny there was no genocide?
You see,
yes or no, that's all I'm asking.
Yeah, well, you see, when you ask a yes or no question, you're the one that decides what genocide means in your own head. And I'm not going to answer a question where you provide the definition of the word. I'll answer my definition of what I think the evidence shows. That doesn't mean that I know what happened. I just know what the evidence shows.
Well, if you don't know what happened, then I guess the answer is I don't know.
Well,
that's
true.
Yes, according to your definition,
that,
would appreciate
that's,
if you say,
I,
yes, but this is my definition of genocide, or no, because this is my definition.
Listen,
what,
look, I'm a lawyer,
right,
which means I'm very careful about what I say I know and what I don't know.
And that's smart, yeah.
That's normal.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
I know what the evidence is the prosecution presented. Huh? I know that they presented the argument that there was a long-term conspiracy. And they presented the story that the Rwandan government has told about what happened in Rwanda. I know that that story was not supported by the evidence, according to the court. Now, maybe that is what actually happened, but that was not supported by the evidence. I know that this alternative story was supported by evidence that's in UN files, that by multiple sources, that is supported by a logical analysis of facts that are outside of the UN files, and it makes sense to me. Is that what happened? I don't know. It's logical from my viewpoint, but I can't tell you I knew that it happened, for sure. And you see, the problem is that it's inconvenient to use logic that comes to a contrary conclusion than the one that Paul Kagame would like, and that's the reason I'm accused. What did I do just now? Did I deny genocide? No, I used logic and evidence to to reach a conclusion. Because that's what courts do. They don't make arguments based on faith.
That statement, the kind of statement that you made?
Yeah, that's
what got you arrested, and it's why there's still a warrant against you right now in Rwanda. The government that you represent, your government agrees that there's a genocide, the United Nations, every single person that you listed, Romeo Dallaire, everybody.
Actually, see, that's not true, because I'm the first person that has had access to these documents. That's the difference. This is the first time that these documents that had been suppressed have gotten out into the world.
You're entitled to your research, but I'm just saying that's what got you in trouble, and that's what will get you in trouble if you go back to Rwanda.
Well, you know, it is a dictatorship, and anyone who disagrees with Kagame ends up in big trouble. So, and we both know that. Even his cousin, who used to be the U.S. ambassador, just got 40 years for, you know, being on the wrong side of things. Yeah. Sorry, go ahead.
Hi. I'm Armenian, and we had a genocide, and there's United Nations definitions of genocide. So I was wondering, what is your definition of genocide?
I don't have a separate definition of genocide. I'm talking, first of all, the definition of genocide is part of that's in the Genocide Convention.
Mm-hmm. And do you agree with that definition?
It's not a matter of agreement or not agreement. That's what the definition is, because that's what the Genocide Convention says. Mm-hmm. It's like, do you agree or not agree with the definition of homicide? That's what the definition is. It's what the law is.
Well, under that United Nations definition of genocide, that would actually be a Rwandan genocide.
Well, have it your way. But the definition of genocide does not include anything having to do with a government. First of all, it doesn't have anything to do with a mass event. The definition of genocide could be one act of violence. Is that your definition of genocide?
No, there's several principles, you know, like, for instance, a plan to exterminate.
Yeah, but see, that's not part of the that's not part of the definition.
That is part of it.
No, actually, it's not part of
it.
No, I'm sorry. I know you think it's part of the definition, but it's not. Neither is it a mass killing is not part of the definition, nor is government policy part of the definition. Really.
Okay, I'm going to go on the computer right now and print out the list of... okay, I'll be right back.
Yeah, and print out the Genocide Convention, if you would.
1956, right?
1948.
48. I'm from the Congo.
Yeah.
And I came here to listen to you because I know that Rwanda is connected to the Congo.
It is.
But I just wanted to say to the people who do not know is that Paul Kagame has agents all over the world. Right now.
Yeah. Some are here tonight.
Yeah, including here tonight.
Yeah.
Persecuting everyone that is going to even question the crimes that Paul Kagame has committed. So when you hear somebody from Rwanda arguing with you, you know they are paid agents of Paul Kagame. And we need to know that. People need to know that. You are, as you said, you are wanted, dead or alive. No president of any country that is democratic will issue something like that against an international lawyer who is only doing his job. And so I think that the people should know that it's a shame that for Africa and for us, who, like the Congo, is going through the same kind of killing, mass killing, that you have, and I think we can compare this to Nazi Germany. We have Nazi agents who went all over the place trying to wipe out anybody that was against what they were doing. So I would like maybe for you to finish the lecture, and then when you finish, then let them, you know, say what they want to say, because we can even listen to you and not have a debate for things that you are showing the evidence already. Let them go to the UN and argue with the evidence, not with you, because you are only bringing the message to us. Thank you.
If anyone has any questions about my presentation, I'm happy to...
I would like to answer that. Just 2 seconds about what he just said. Because I want to make clear about what he's saying. We're not representing Kagame.
Who's we? Are you saying we?
Now, he just said whoever's... Kagame has agencies all over the world. We are representing our people as Rwandese. So we're not representing Kagame. We don't work for Kagame. We don't work for any agency. Just
well, don't you come here right now?
Yes.
So why are you saying we?
No, because he used you. Also, he generalized people. So I'm. Well, I assume there's people who probably share that.
It's very simple. I just want to make sure that he understands that we are not here to. We're not working for Kagame agencies.
Okay. Well, let's assume that that was that.
I mean, we can let you continue. We ask questions as personal.
Sure.
So he needs to stop generalizing because we present ourselves.
Okay.
And our ideas and what we stand for.
Do you know everybody here?
No, I don't.
You don't know everybody here. Well,
maybe. Well, speaking for yourself. Yes. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I just have some questions on your presentation.
Sure.
First of all, on the definition of genocide, I think there's a definition, a clear definition that is in a convention.
And what is it?
There is a clear convention.
Tell me what the definition is.
I don't have that in my mind.
Well, then don't
but it's to target people for who they are. Either a national group, an ethnic group, a racial group, a religious group, in whole or part.
That's true.
That is the definition
that's true.
Of genocide.
That's true.
It's first.
Yes, that's true.
Second, you have said after the Bagosora case, the following. I found it on the internet. Can the tragedy that engulfed Rwanda properly be called a genocide at all? Or was it closer to a case of civilians being caught up in wartime violence like the Eastern Front in World War II rather than the plan behind the lion's killings in Nazi death camps? And you went on to say, after the assassination of Juvenal Habyarimana, Rwanda's former president, the Rwandan military leaders had a characteristic behavior of a war situation. Their behavior was normal in the circumstances. Their behavior was normal.
Excuse me. Let me respond to the first part, and then I'll respond to the second part. Okay?
Okay. That's
okay. Yeah. Let's no. Let's do this. Let's just start.
I didn't finish to ask the question.
Please. Let's do this in an orderly fashion. You started with the first part. Let's do that, and then let's respond to the second part.
Can I finish all my questions? And then you can ask.
Let's do it in an orderly fashion. Do the first part, and then we'll do the second part. Possible?
Okay.
The first part that you add was, can you ask me the first part again, please? Because it is my writing. Please?
Yes, I found it on the website.
Yes.
I think you know him, Jean-Marie Ferrer-Nagima. He had a website called
It's my writing. It's my writing.
Yes.
Yes.
Do you want me to repeat?
I want you to read the first part and let me respond to that, and then read the second part so I can respond to that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Can the tragedy that engulfed Rwanda properly be called a genocide at all?
Okay.
Or was it closer to a case of civilians being caught up in wartime violence?
Can you stop for just
like,
a moment? Please, can you stop for just a moment?
Like the Eastern Front in World War II.
Yeah. Can you wait for just a moment? Do you notice that that's an interrogative? That's asking a question. Did you notice that? It's not making a statement. It's asking a question. Did you notice that?
What about a second part?
No, hold on, please. I'm doing this for a reason, because I want to show you how it is you are misinterpreting my words. Now, hold on, please. You had your say. I want to answer in turn, right? You notice that's an interrogative. It's saying, can it be characterized this way? It's asking a question, not making a statement.
Good.
Okay? Okay, that's number one. Can we go back to the... let's go back to what the finding of the court was. Back here. Okay. Here's what the court found regarding those four officers. When viewed against the backdrop of targeted killings and massive slaughter perpetrated by civilians and assailants between April and July, as well as earlier cycles of violence, it's understandable why this evidence, why for many, this evidence shows a prior conspiracy to commit genocide. However, they are also consistent with preparations for a political or military power struggle when confronted with, which means that they are also consistent with the normal military situation. That's what I was referring to. That's what the judgment said.
May I come back on that?
Please.
Thank you. For your interrogative part of the statement, you didn't answer on the second part,
okay, well,
which was not interrogative.
Okay, let's do that.
When you were saying that,
I have
that after the assassination of Juvenal Habyarimana, the Rwandan military leaders had a characteristic behavior over war situation. Their behavior was normal in the circumstances. And you forgot to tell us what was the sentence in the Bagosora case, because he was sentenced to life for genocide, organizing the military to kill former Prime Minister Agathe Uwilingiyimana, the President of the Supreme Court, Joseph Kavalugana, ministers, people all around me saying, I have the case. You chose few paragraphs in the judgment, and you forgot to tell us what happened to Bagosora. Because when we listen, when we look to your slides, we can understand that Bagosora was acquitted, but he was sentenced because he organized after the downfall of the plan, the plan of Habyarimana, he organized a genocide with his military throughout the country. It was not a case of civilian who were angry because their president was dead, because it was organized by Bagosora, who was sentenced to life by ICTR. Why did you choose few paragraphs, not tell us about the whole judgment? Then.
Okay. Well, let me respond. Thank you. One of the disadvantages of not having been in court for 7 years and reading that huge document is that it is difficult to understand, and I appreciate that. And part of the reason that it's difficult to understand is the reason that we know from the situation that Carlo Del Ponte explained. Because any judge who doesn't follow the instructions in the way that Carlo Del Ponte didn't follow the instructions is not going to have a very long UN career. So first of all, we have to understand that there was an objective in writing that judgment. And it was extraordinary that the judges found Bagosora and others not guilty of conspiracy, and they couldn't find them not guilty of conspiracy because the evidence that we provided that there was no conspiracy and that there were no crimes committed by these officers in terms of long-term conspiracy was so strong. What Bagasaur was actually convicted of, the events, no matter what one calls them, which is up to the judges to call them whatever they want, and with the Carlo Del Ponte message, of course, they have to make sure they call them the worst that they can call them. He was convicted of not having done enough to stop crimes committed by soldiers who were not soldiers under his command on the night of April 6th, the day and night of April 7th, and the day and night of April 8th. That's all. No crimes committed before April 6th, no crimes committed after April 8th. Just those 3 days.
It's a lie. I have the judgment here.
No.
How can you say that? I have the judgment here. How can you say that? Please.
Well, my friend.
Do you want me to read the judgment here?
My friend. We'll end up. I know what the judgment says about all of the. No, you don't have the judgment. The judgment is 680 pages.
No, it is a summary from the UN ICTR.
I understand that you couldn't possibly, unless you read the 680 pages, please don't trouble me. Yes, sir.
When you were on the panel with the two Spaniards at the International Global Information Network, there were two or three people in the audience who took violent exception to what you were saying.
Yeah.
And putting out the videotape, a couple of people have recognized people there as being attached to the Rwandan embassy in Washington. And at least one or two reappeared at one of the screenings of Conroe in Harlem series back in September. And I'm wondering, are any of the people here tonight, were any of you at either one of those events? The panel, which Professor earlier spoke with the two Spanish representatives, or the Conroe and Harlem series. The gentleman at the back there, were you there?
Sorry?
Were you at either one of those events?
Who's the presenter? The presenter is
here. I'm Congolese, I'm from Congo. I have just one question to everybody. Who's supposed to define genocide? Is the government of one country, as Rwanda or Congo or Sudan or I don't know? Is people on the street like we are here, because some people stand up for genocide? Or is the UN who's supposed to say, okay, something happened in one is named, what happened in one was genocide? Or is a court? Because in Congo now, people say we have genocide in Congo. People say we have war crime in Congo. But we have to wait until the court say that what is happening in Congo today is a genocide. So I want to know if Kagame, Rwanda, or Congo, or Sudan, or United States have the power to say what is going in Congo or what happened in Rwanda was a genocide. Or people in the street, like we are here, some people think to be really smart, they can decide that will have, this is a genocide, this is not a genocide. Or the UN, or the court. If we read what happened about the ICTR, I don't know if you can see clearly, they don't talk about genocide there. But anyone have a right, I'm not talking to you, don't talk to me, I'm talking to you. You gotta give your answer if you want there. When we read the definition of genocide, it has to be preparation. Trust me, I'm against the killing of Tutsi, I'm against the killing of Hutu, I'm against the killing of anyone. So if they kill Tutsi, I'm against that. If they kill Hutu, I'm against that. Like they're killing us now, Congolese in Congo, I am against. So to talk about genocide, to insist that something happened, what happened to one was terrible. No one can support that. It's just about the word genocide. Who has the power to say that? What happened? Rwanda was a genocide. Who has the power to say that what's going on in Congo today is a genocide? Is you? Is me? Is your country? Is my country? Is the president of country? Or is the UN? Or is the court? So if it's the court, we have to follow the ICTR. Like in Congo case now, everybody said that the report said that we have to wait until one court prove that what's happening in Congo today is a genocide. So if the ICTR said that it was a genocide, we're gonna go with that. If the ICTR said it wasn't a genocide, so stop talking, stop wasting your time. Thank you.
Arguments, the evidence that they used. This is the testimonies of a number of individuals who at one point or other were associated with the RPF. As you are aware, and I'm sure you are aware because you are obviously on top of this, most of this evidence has been turned down. The indictments have collapsed, and we are in a situation whereby you and others putting forward essentially what I would at least describe as a revisionist view of many of these things you've kind of lost your sense of objectivity. And this is understandable given the pressures and difficulties you face. But really, in the light of the evidence you're supporting, would you please like to elaborate a little more on, let's say, your criteria for admission of evidence? Thank you.
Anybody else? Or would you like to respond, Professor Olande?
Well, I don't know that response is really necessary because I'm well aware that this topic is very difficult for people in Rwanda for a number of reasons, not the least of which is that the government apparently has opposition that, of course, is not my concern because I'm not involved in Rwandan politics, nor will I be. And it's not up for me to decide how the Rwandese people should govern their affairs. I have enough trouble trying to figure out how the United States should govern its affairs. But what I am very concerned about is that the United States had a history in the last century of supporting dictatorial governments in Latin America and in manipulating the politics of Latin America. And the Latin Americans understand the concept of a gringo and Yankee, and it's only been recently that in Latin America the forces of liberation and independence have been able to fight back the worst aspects of American manipulation in Latin America. And irrespective of whether you think I've gotten the facts right in the particulars with respect, at the evidence. I appreciate the distinction, and I think that that's a we can refer also to the documents. But my major concern is that there's no question that the ICTR has been manipulated by the United States, and I think my own opinion is that the documents also show that the United States has given the RPF a free ride. And that's my view of the United States policy, not my view of the RPF. And I think it's a huge mistake for the United States to have that sort of manipulative policy towards Africa. And I think the mistake is being made in Sudan. I think that the reaction of the Kenyan parliament recently with respect to voting to withdraw from the Rome Statute, the use of Rwandan and Ugandan troops as proxies in Sudan and Somalia is a huge mistake. And I would hope that that mistake is not made by the United States in the next century as it in Africa, as it had, as mistakes that have been made in Latin America in the last century. If one is to find a bad actor that's really culpable in all this, it's those who made Kagame, not Kagame himself. And I think those are in the Pentagon. I think that's what the evidence shows.
Hi. Why exactly is the United States interested in Rwanda? And what's the relationship between what's going on in Rwanda and Congo?
Well, Rwanda borders on Congo, of course, and Uganda and Rwanda invaded Congo in 96 and again in 98. That's well known. And then according to the UN reports, and again, I'm not an African expert, so I could just have read the reports, but reports that were commissioned by experts from the Security Council, 300-page reports that nature, footnoted and documented. First was in 2001, talking about the illegal extraction of resources, because Congo is an extraordinarily rich area that's not well-developed, has a lot of the resources that industrial countries need. Africa is the least developed continent, and one that both the U.S. and China are contesting over now, and of course the Europeans have for a long time. According to the Security Council experts report of 2001, illegal extraction of resources by the Rwandan and Ugandan militaries and governments have been going on for some time. Similar reports were issued in 2002, and then another report was issued in 2003. The report in 2008 also included reports that the groups, that armed groups that were opposing the Rwandan government were also engaged in this extractions. And then the report on October 10th, which is about 600 pages, made clear that the Rwandan government was using the excuse that there were genocidaires in the Congo as a excuse to invade the Congo, and that in fact was really the real reason was to occupy the Congo. Now, I don't know if that's true or not, but that is what the 600-page report from the High Commissioner for Human Rights said in the 600-page report. So it's a matter of also Global Witness, a group in D.C. has reported on the same thing with extensively. Adam Hochschild, the author of King Leopold's Ghost, has put the figure on the amount of the extraction of resources at about 250 million a year, which is about what the members of Congress said the U.S. aid is. So it's about 500 million a year going to Rwanda, according to those sources. Maybe the sources are wrong, but that's what the sources say.
Hi, I have a quick question, and my question actually goes to the motive. Because I just don't understand why someone like you, who claims to be a human rights lawyer, comes all the way from Minnesota, which I'm sure is a pretty comfortable place, goes all the way to Rwanda, involve yourself in things you claim yourself you don't know very little about, or you are not there, and then you come here going around this country, putting together selective evidence, which you know it's selective, because you tend to agree with what the court says in your favor, putting a doubt in where in people's head whether genocide actually happened, and rejecting other things that the court says. I'm not so worried about your selective way of how you choose evidence in this case, but I don't understand the motive. Is it, because if you came here and you said, I don't like Kagame, he's a dictator, I don't like him, that is, nobody will, people may come who support Kagame may come and argue with you, that is a political stand. But to come here and then put, you say you don't deny genocide, but I think you, the case is, the case against you in terms of being a genocide denier is pretty clear by now.
And would you...
Let me just finish. I mean, you're going to have to let me finish. I'll give you all the time you want.
Oh, well, thank you so much.
because you've been speaking all day. You've been speaking all day. I think I should be allowed to speak. So I just don't understand. Is it because Kagame arrested you, your feelings were hurt? Is it because you were arrested in Rwanda and your feelings were hurt? Because I don't understand. Because all the evidence, again, what you say is pretty weak for a lawyer. I mean, I'm quite unimpressed with what you present. So I'm just trying to understand, why do you call yourself a human rights lawyer and you do, the first thing you do is deny a genocide? Thank you.
May I respond?
No, you may not.
Okay.
Professor Erinda, you may not respond.
Oh, well, I'm in your hands.
Okay. Listen, brothers and sisters, some of us here are fellow Africans, all right? There's no need for you guys to be disingenuous about making an argument that doesn't make any sense, all right? You don't, if you support your government, fair enough. You can do that, all right? But the evidence that Professor Erinda provided are not his evidence. He didn't go into Rwanda looking for those evidence. Those evidence that he presented to us tonight are public records. I'm from Nigeria, West Africa. I'm ashamed of a lot of the stuff that is going on the continent. All right? Now, for young people like us, right, to not be open-minded enough to take on the challenges that are going on our continent, I'm afraid that's where the real problem is. Whether you are paid by Kagame's government or not is irrelevant. Kagame will not live forever. He won't be president forever. Right? But you are going to inherit that country, and you are going to have to fix the crap that is being developed in your country right now. So the earlier you rise up to that challenge, it's not about whether he's right or wrong, the better for you guys. That's all I have to say. The fact that, the fact of who Kagame is not a mystery to anybody. You can't come here to try to convince us with your perfect English or your nice jackets that, you know, you can't do that, all right? I'm from Nigeria. We do it better than you guys. You guys are children when it comes to it.
You see, that's open debate.
Okay? No, it is. It may be.
Yes.
So we can talk. But listen, there's no need for you guys to come here in suits
and pretend to be what you are not. That's all I'm saying.
What do you have against suits?
I don't wear them, as a matter of fact, because I'm an African. I'm not a copycat European.
Can you give back to the man who was here for him, not for you?
I have a question, Professor Erlander, that I'd like to ask.
Who's knocking? Oh, Kazembe. Can somebody open the door in the back? Yeah.
Two things. The attack by Rwanda and Uganda of Congo, and what was said in the mapping report that came out last year in 2010, is this, what's the connection between the desire to keep separate the question of Kagame and genocide in 1994 and these later developments? Because many people last year when the mapping report came out understood immediately the connection between what had happened in 94 and what had happened in 96 and 97. So I'm just would like to hear, this young woman asked us to keep separate the question of Congo and what happened in 94. And I'm asking, is there a reason why somebody would want to keep that separate? Or can something be said about that, the meaning of the mapping report in that regard?
Well, it's kind of difficult to think about the RPF being the saviors of Rwanda and being and committing genocide in the Congo at the same time, which is what the mapping report suggests, because the mapping report suggests that the crimes, or perhaps crimes against humanity and war crimes, because one of the problems that we had earlier here is by using the word genocide, it's so politicized, and it's the problem we had of figuring out precisely what the definition is. That actually is a real problem, because when people think of genocide, what is in their head is what the Nazis did. And that's what people think the definition is. In fact, that is not what the definition is. It's become so politicized beyond that that it is very difficult to talk about it rationally. And particularly when it's applied in a particular situation, like the Armenian situation, like the Rwandan situation. I mean, you said I've denied genocide. One thing I was going to ask you is how I did it, because I don't know. I really don't. But I'm not done yet, so I wanted to have the explanation, right? It's really a serious question. But for example, in this mapping report, the mapping report says that across the border from Rwanda in 1993 and in 1994. And again, maybe the mapping report is wrong. But the mapping report says that elements of the RPF were committing massive crimes in the Congo. Well, the jurisdiction of the RPF, of the ICTR, includes areas surrounding Rwanda, and the ICTR should be prosecuting those crimes as well. But the ICTR, as we know, has plenty of evidence about RPF crimes committed in Rwanda as well, and hasn't prosecuted those for the reasons Carla Del Ponte has explained. One of the things that concerns me about the ICTR being manipulated this way, and now it being well known that it's been manipulated this way, is it really works against the Rwandan people. And here's why I think it does. The majority of Rwanda are Hutu. If the ICTR is seen by the majority of Rwandans as demonizing the majority and giving the minority a free ride, because the Hutus know that crimes were committed by the RPF, and you know they know that. And if they feel that they've been demonized by the minority, and there's some basis for it, it's going to be a long time before reconciliation happens in Rwanda. And the minority can't stay well enough armed long enough to be reconciled with the majority. And I'm really afraid that it's going to be very hard for people to talk with each other in a way that South Africa figured out to do this, because in the truth and reconciliation process, what they did was both sides said, you know, we've got a piece of this problem. We've both done wrong. We've both got something to apologize to the other for. We've both done wrong. And it's only, I think, when both sides have acknowledged that they've got a piece of the problem that it's going to be possible to reconcile in the future. And I might be wrong. It might be possible for there to be an armed minority that's able to maintain power, and things will be fine in Rwanda going into the future. But I don't think that would have happened in the United States in our civil war, and I'm really afraid that that's not likely to happen in Rwanda either. Whether you agree with me or not, whether you think I'm a genocide denier or not, I think that as a matter of practical reality, it's buying enormous trouble for the Rwandan people going forward. And again, I'm not a Rwandan, but I do know that if a similar thing had happened in the United States after our Civil War, we would have had a hell of a problem reconciling.
Hi. Can you talk about the role of the U.S. in the Congo? What is the role and what are the connections?
Yeah. I want to refer you also to the research that's been done by Global Witness. They have done an excellent job tracking the role of U.S. and not only U.S. but NATO related corporations in the Eastern Congo. Because of the U.S., increasing U.S. military presence in Africa through AFRICOM, this military command structure that the U.S. has set up, military relationships with both Rwanda and Uganda, who are playing the major military role in the Eastern Congo, the U.S. is, and because the U.S. Has turned a blind eye to the military penetration of the Eastern Congo by Rwanda and Uganda, the U.S. has engineered a number of deals, but is not in a position to hold anyone to account, because the breadcrumbs lead back to the U.S. for an awful lot of the violence that's occurred there. There's an article by Herman Cohn, who was in the Bush State Department. It was published in the New York Times in December of 2008, in which he proposes unifying the economies of Rwanda, Uganda, and the Eastern Congo, because Uganda and Rwanda are actually running the economy of the Eastern Congo now. We might as well just admit it, because they control it. And the U.S. has made that all possible because of the support for Rwanda and Uganda that has gone on since now. And when you ask the question about motivation, my motivation is that it's the abuse of power by the United States that concerns me greatly, with the Indian community, with the attacks on Muslims in the United States. I began my career defending Vietnam veterans who came back from a war that was fought on behalf of the United States, and then they were prosecuted criminally because they had psychological disorders from fighting in Vietnam, and it turned my stomach. And the abuse of power by the United States still turns my stomach, and that's happening in Africa, and the Rwandan people are victims, and it's happening in the ICTR.
Well, we have time for about one more question, if you'll allow Professor.
One more.
I wonder if you can sort of put the focal plane a little more closely on the U.S., particularly, you see any difference between the Bush 2 administration and the Obama administration, and what is the role of Susan Rice in all this?
There is a difference between the Bush administration and the Obama administration. Obama issued a statement, well, the National Security Council issued a statement from the White House on August 9th after the Rwandan election, criticizing the violence, the elimination of closing newspapers, the elimination of political opponents in the Rwanda, saying that an election doesn't make a democracy, and it was the first real criticism of the Kagame regime from the White House, and that didn't happen under Bush. There's been increasing attention paid to the abuses of human rights by the White House. Pentagon policy hasn't changed, and 2 weeks ago, the head of AFRICOM was in Kigali, scoping out Kigali as a site for the location of AFRICOM headquarters, and had a lot of public meetings with Kagame, which gave him, I think, additional reason for feeling that he was still in good graces with the Pentagon. However, there's also a lot of uncertainty because former supporters of the Kagame regime are leaving and going into asylum and being convicted in absentia. Four former members of the regime were sentenced in absentia last week to 40 years or more. And the criticism of the dictatorship is increasing around the world. He's not able to get the same human rights bear hug that Bill Clinton gave him last December. I unfortunately believed that things had changed in Rwanda and thought that he wouldn't jeopardize his human rights standing by arresting me, so I was a fool.
Thank you very much, Professor Erlander, for coming. I really appreciate it. And please, everybody, remember that the Alambe Brath Lectures are going to be starting next Tuesday, February 1st, here at the Breck Forum, and you're all invited. We'll hear a couple of talks about Sudan, one about Darfur, a very closely related topic to what we talked about today, and one about South Sudan. So thank you all very much, and I look forward to seeing you again.